Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Shayantoni Pal, Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, University of Calcutta. Today, our subject is Indian culture. The paper is on Indian polity, and today we shall discuss on the political and the administrative policies of the Rajputs. The Rajputs were one of the most important groups in the political arena of North India in the early medieval period. Now, here are our learning objectives. First, we shall study the sources regarding the political and administrative policies of the Rajputs. Then we shall study the status claimed by the Rajput kings, since there are many inscriptions which claim different status in different periods by the Rajput kings. So we shall analyze the status claimed by the Rajput kings in different periods. Then we shall study the organization of the Rajput kingdoms. Then our next topic would be the marriage alliances, which played a very important role in the organization of the Rajput power structure. Then we shall study the Chaurasia system. Now, this Chaurasia system is a very important system of land distribution. This is seen among the Rajput dynasties. Then we shall study the role of forts in the Rajput polity. Then we shall study the economic structure of the Rajput kingdoms, the changes in the meaning of the term Rajputs, and finally we shall conclude our lecture. Now you can see this is a painting of the Rajputs. It was painted in 1876. As you can see, here are the Rajputs they were actually warriors, and in this picture they are with their weapons. So as you can see, the Rajputs were actually very popular for their chivalry and their heroism. This is again a painting. This painting shows the procession by a king, as you can see, and this is a very popular scene in the court of the Rajputs. Now, the introduction. The Rajputs came to the forefront of the political arena in the early medieval period. Now, early medieval period, as we have already discussed in another module, this period starts in 6th century CE and it ends in 12th or 13th century CE. This is known as the early medieval period, and in this period the Rajputs were one of the most important groups in the political arena of North India. This term, the Rajput, it is derived from the term Rajaputra, which frequently appears in inscriptions dated from the 7th to 8th centuries. In the inscriptions, mainly consisting of land grants, which actually record the grant of land to religious beneficiaries, these Rajaputras appear as a group amongst all the other military and administrative officials. So the Rajaputras actually appear in the inscriptions as a group whom addresses were made in the order of the land grants. By the 12th century, the 36 clans of the Rajputs became very traditional in North India. We have reference to the 36 clans. Now, 36 is a conventional number. Sometimes we get the number 36, sometimes we get more than 36. So this is a very conventional number. The 36 clans of the Rajputs are mentioned in some early medieval texts like the Raja Tarangini of Kalhan, the Kumara Palacharita, the Prithvi Raja Rasa, the Aparajita Pritcha. These are several in early medieval texts which mentions the 36 clans of the Rajputs. But when we will study the composition of this list, we shall see that this actually comprised of a mixed group. This was not at all a homogeneous group. Now, the process of the emergence of the lineages claiming the Rajput status had some common pattern and features which we shall study and analyze in course of our lecture, and this was actually connected with the historical processes, the other historical processes. What are the other historical processes? There were agrarian expansion in an area. There were increase of settlements. So actually, the origin of the Rajputs, the rise of the Rajputs, are associated in different areas with these types of historical processes. In this map, you shall see a distribution of the Rajputs in modern India. So there are several Rajput clans in modern India, and you will see the more greener parts of the map represents the areas dominated by the Rajputs, and they are actually located more in the western part and also in the central part of India. They are much less in the southern part and the eastern part of India. So the Rajputs actually occupied the area in western part of India and in central part of India, comprising Gujarat, Rajasthan, the western part of Madhya Pradesh, and so on. Now, the sources for study of the political administrative structure of the Rajputs. There are a large number of inscriptions consisting of land grants, which I have already discussed about the land grants, and there are several panegyrics. Panegyrics are actually prashastis. They were usually engraved on stone and they were composed by the court poets of the royal dynasties. So there are several land grants and panegyrics of the dynasties which claim Rajput status. These inscriptions also contain references to their origin myths and how they trace their descent from some epic heroes or some sages, etc. So these inscriptions actually contain a large number of data regarding how the several Rajput dynasties explain their origin and their rise to power. Then there are some early medieval texts like the Raja Tarangini, the Prithvi Raja Rasa, etc. They refer to the Rajput clans as numbering 36, which I have already discussed. Some of the legends, the bardic tradition, they contain a story regarding the origin of the Rajputs. There is a story. This story actually appeared much earlier in some texts like the Mahabharata. In some of the Puranas, this story appeared. But later, this story again appeared in the bardic tradition. This story tells us that there was a sage called Vasishtha, and he had a cow, a wish-fulfilling cow, which was stolen by another sage, Vidya-mitra. So then Vasishtha actually offered something, made some offerings in a sacrificial fire pit at the Abu mountain. And from that fire, a hero came and he was ordered by Vasishtha to bring back his cow. Now this hero brought back this cow and Vasishtha became very satisfied and he named this hero as Paramaro. So Paramaros, actually it is the name of a dynasty who claimed the Rajput status. The Paramaros were one of the most important group among the 36 clans of the Rajputs, while the other groups are the Kalachuris, the Pratiharas, the Choulukkas. There are several important Rajput clans among whom the Paramaros have mentioned this story. Now we will discuss in detail the claim for political status made by the Rajputs in their inscriptions. There is the theory called Agnikula, that is origin from a fire pit at Mount Abu, which I have just discussed. There is another claim put forward in the inscriptions of the Rajputs regarding the Brahma Kshatriya status. Now, what is the Brahma Kshatriya status? It is a mixed status. The Brahma Kshatriya actually originated from an intermarriage between the Brahmana and the Kshatriya. So when somebody is claiming the Brahma Kshatriya status, actually he claims both the Brahmana status and the Kshatriya status. But why people used to do so? Because the Brahmana blood was pure. So in order to claim purity of descent, one would claim the Brahmana status. And then why Kshatriya status? The Kshatriyas were actually the rulers. To be a ruler, one should belong to a Kshatriya caste. This norm has been set by the authors of the Dharma Shastras. So in order to put their claim for rulership, people, the dynasties claim the Kshatriya status. So the Brahma Kshatriya is actually a mixed status which were claimed by these different Rajput dynasties. Then there is another claim regarding the connection of these Rajput dynasties with Surya Vansha or Chandra Vansha. Some of the dynasties, some of the Rajput dynasties claimed that they have originated from the Surya Vansha or the solar line, while others like the Shenas of Bengal, they claimed their origin from the Chandra Vansha or the lunar dynasty. So these are another claims put forward by the Rajput dynasties in their inscriptions. And lastly, they would always connect themselves in the genealogies with some epic heroes like Rama, like Lakshmana. Actually, the Gurjara Pratiharas, it was the Gurjara Pratiharas who claimed that they originated from the epic hero Lakshmana. And in other cases, they also trace their origin from renowned sages like Vashishta and also from renowned kings like Prithu, Sagara, etc. Now, the process of legitimation by the Rajputs. In reality, the dynasties claiming the Rajput status came from a varied background. This will be apparent if we study the list of the 36 clans in the early medieval texts regarding the Rajputs. We will find there the Paramaras, the Pratiharas, the Cholukkos, who were actually indigenous dynasties. But there were several groups who were actually non-indigenous, like the Hunas. They appear in the list of the 36 clans of the Rajputs. But as we know that the Hunas were actually a non-indigenous power. They came from Central Asia and they entered India in the 5th century CE. So this non-indigenous power, the Hunas, they appear in the list of the 36 clans of the Rajputs. Then we have the reference to the Medas, who were actually tribals. They also appear in the list of the 36 clans of the Rajputs. So these 36 clans of the Rajputs were actually a mixed group. None of them can be regarded as purely indigenous or purely foreign. This was a mixed group. So we can see that these 36 clans of the Rajputs were actually a mixed group. They were not homogeneous. Now, most of these dynasties, they must have originally received land grants from the kings in return to their service. So originally, most of the members of these dynasties might have been actually feudatories or subordinates of the ruling kings. Besides, there are high administrative offices which could also facilitate an upwardly moving status. Like if one is a high rank official like the Mahamandaleshwara or the Mahasenapati, he has more power and he can aspire for more power and become independent. So this high administrative office could actually also facilitate an upwardly moving status. Again, there were some forest tribes about whom I have already mentioned. There is the reference to the Medas in the 36 clans of the Rajputs. So some of the clans were actually conquered and they later appeared in the list of the 36 clans of the Rajputs. So now I can discuss some data analyzed by B.D. Chattopadhyay in his seminal work, The Origin of the Rajputs. In this work, in this article, he has studied several the claim for origin made by several Rajput dynasties. But as a case study, we shall study only the case of the Gurjara Pratiharas. Now, the Gurjaras had a distribution throughout the western and the central part of India. Several Gurjara kings are found in Rajasthan as well as in Kannagurja. Now, the most famous among them was the Gurjara Pratiharas, who actually conquered the power at Kannauj. But there were several Gurjara families like those in Jodhpur, those in Nandipuri, those in Mandar. There were several Gurjara families. Now, B.D. Chattopadhyay studied the claim for origin put forward by these Gurjara families. In an earlier period, in the 7th century, when they did not rose to power, they did not capture power at Kannagurja, they were claiming feudatory status for them, and they traced their origin from the epic hero Karna. So this was a rather humble claim for origin put forward by the Gurjaras of Nandipuri in the 7th century CE when they were feudatories. But later on, in the 9th century, when they captured power in Kanyakubjo, they claimed their origin from the Surya Vansha. They claimed that the epic hero Raghu or Rama is their ancestor. So this is a very elaborate claim, a high sounding claim put forward by the Gurjara Pratiharas, a branch of the Gurjaras, when they captured power in Kanyakubja and dominated the other rulers. So you can easily see the difference. When a dynasty, when a power is in a subordinate status, the claim for origin put forward them is rather in a low tone, and when they captured power, they became sovereign, they are putting some high sounding claims for their origin. So this, there are several case studies made by Bidhi Chattopadhyay in his work, The Origin of the Rajputs. Now, the Brahma Kshatriya. As I have already discussed, that the Brahma Kshatriya status was put forward by the several Rajput families. But when? Bidhi Chattopadhyay suggested that the Brahma Kshatriya was actually a transitional status. This was put forward by the dynasties when they moved from a feudatory to a sovereign status. Then they were putting the claims for their Brahma Kshatriya status. But as soon as they capture power and become sovereign and dominate the others, they never claim this status. They then claim much high sounding, they then make some high sounding claims. Now, this Brahma Kshatriya status was claimed by the lineages aspiring for power. Now, the transition from the feudatory to independent status was through the growth of military strength. As you know, that when ruler becomes more powerful and he acquires more power, he becomes indispensable to his overlord. When the overlord makes some expedition, he requires the help of this feudatory. So there was the growth of military strength, and through this growth of military strength, one can rise to power. Now, the emergence of the early Rajput clans actually took place within the existing hierarchical political structure. This is because there are some earlier views which suggested that the origin of the rise of the Rajputs, the emergence of the Rajputs in the political arena was brilliant and remarkable, and it was a sudden emergence. But what Bidhi Chattopadhyay wanted to emphasize is that it is not at all sudden. It is associated, the rise of Rajputs, which he calls the process of Rajputization, is actually associated with other historical processes, and it took place within the existing hierarchical structure of polity of early medieval India. So the rise of the Rajputs, according to Bidhi Chattopadhyay, is not at all sudden. Now, we shall study something about the organization of the Rajput kingdoms. The focus of each Rajput kingdom was the territory over which the lineage had direct control. So, we may regard this as their core territory over which the lineage, the term lineage in the inscription in Sanskrit, is it has been referred to as Vansha, Kula, Anvaya, etc. So, the core territory over which the lineage had direct control was the focus. Then there were the neighboring areas, the surrounding areas. They were occupied their branch families. Now, this is very interesting, because if the core area was occupied by the main family and the surrounding area is occupied by the branch family, so this actually consolidates the power base of the dynasty. Since the main area is occupied by themselves and the surrounding area is occupied by the branches. Now, the main family distributed land among their kinsmen. This is a very interesting feature, a remarkable feature of the Rajput polity, that they liked to distribute land surrounding their core area only to their kinsmen, their blood relations. And some of the grantees were not actual kinsmen. Now, this is also interesting, since if one is not a kinsman, why should he claim himself as a kinsman, and why should the main family accept such claims? There were some political motives behind such claims. Now, we shall discuss this through the segmentary lineage system. this may be regarded, this, I mean, the thing I have discussed, that the main core area is occupied by the main family and the surrounding area is occupied by the branch family. This is called the segmentary lineage system. This could often incorporate non-kinship related families as a segment of the main line. The main lineage and the subsidiary ones had to maintain a mutually agreed kinship. By mutually agreed kinship, we mean that the main family would regard the non-kins as their kins, and the non-kins would also claim that they were actually kins of the main family. So this is called a mutually agreed kinship. The family of a high rank official who obtained land assignment from the ruling family in return to his service might also claim a lineage link with the ruling family. So there are several families which could actually, which were non-kin, they could actually claim kinship with the ruling families. Now we shall discuss the role of the marriage alliances in the Rajput polity, which was very important and exclusive to the Rajput political structure. The marriage alliance between the main family and another family claiming to be its branch was common among the Rajputs. Now, such marriages had a political aspect, because if the main family is only marrying their daughters into the branch family, actually the land is circulating within their family. It is not going outside to their family. So this also consolidates their power base. So the marriage alliance with the branch families was a very important aspect of the Rajput polities. Now this marriage pattern of the Pratihara families point to the development of the inter-clan relationship, how we will study now. The pattern of marriage alliances in the Rajput dynasties. In some cases, the marriage alliances were made with one or two families. We will find two different types of cases. In some cases, the marriage alliances, the dynasties liked to enter into marriage alliances with one or two families. But in other cases, the marriage networks was much more expansive, like in the case of the Guhilas, who had matrimonial alliances with several Rajput families. So in some cases, marriage alliances were made with one or two families. As for example, we may refer to the marriages of the Chahamanas with the Rashtrakutas and the marriage alliances between the Paramaras with the Chahamanas. In each cases, the marriage alliances were made with a single family. In other cases, the marriage network was much more expansive. As for example, the Guhilas had matrimonial relationship with the Chaulukyas, the Paramaras, the Rashtrakutas, the Chahamanas and also the Hunas. So this is very interesting. The Chahamanas, the Guhilas actually had a range of dynasties with whom they entered into matrimonial relationship. Now see the names, the Chaulukyas, the Paramaras, the Rashtrakutas, the Chahamanas. All of them were indigenous dynasties. But what about the Hunas? The Hunas were actually a non-indigenous power and came from Central Asia. So why did the Guhilas entered into matrimonial relationship with the Hunas? Now this was also again to consolidate their power base, and by entering into matrimonial alliance with an indigenous dynasty like the Guhilas, the Hunas would also get some social status. So this type of marriage alliance between indigenous and non-indigenous dynasty had several aspects, like the political aspect and the also some social aspect. Now, impact of the marriage alliances. What are the impacts of these marriage alliances? Inter-clan marriage networks were limited to the Rajput category. Now, this is very important regarding the development of the Rajput political structure. In the inscriptions of the Rajputs, we always found that Rajput dynasties were actually entering into matrimonial alliances only with the other Rajput dynasties, but they never go outside. As for example, in the inscriptions of the Palas, we will see that they always entered into marriage with the Rashtrakutas. And there are some patterns for marriages among several other families which I have already discussed. So, inter-clan marriage networks among the Rajput family were limited to themselves only. The choice was definitely directed by political motives, which I have already analyzed. It could provide social legitimacy, as I have discussed in the case of the Hunas. Now, collaboration was there in socio-political activities. As for example, in some cases, we find that a member of another dynasty was put in charge of controlling a fort or put in charge of controlling a religious institution by the main dynasty. So there were collaboration in the socio-political activities as a result of such marriage alliances. Now, the inter-clan relationships thus serve as the key in understanding the evolution of the Rajput polity. Now, we shall discuss the Chaurasia system, which is another important system of land distribution among the Rajput dynasties. What is the Chaurasia system? Chaurasia refers to an unit of 84 villages. This is a new land unit consisting of 6 villages or its multiples, which appear in the inscriptions of the Rajput dynasties. The inscriptions actually state that villages were attached to such units. How? When some villages were granted and recorded in the land grants, they always say that this village is attached to. The term for attached to is Pratibaddha. This village is Pratibaddha to this unit of 84 villages. So this unit of 84 villages to which the granted villages were actually attached were actually an administrative unit. So unit of 84 was actually the administrative units arranged by the Rajputs for the development of their power structure. These units thus became the nuclei of some kind of local control. Now, the spread of the Chaurasia system. The earliest evidence regarding the reference to the 84 unit of 84 villages is from Saurashtra towards the close of 9th century. Gradually, we find that this Chaurasia system spread from Saurashtra to Rajasthan, perhaps in order to facilitate the distribution of land and political control among the ruling elites. So you can see how important this system was in the arrangement of the administration of the Rajput territories. The Visaladeva Rasa suggests that by the second half of the 14th century, the Chaurasia or holders of 84 villages had become a well-known class of chiefs. So these Chaurasias, who were actually the holders of a unit of 84 villages, became a very important element in the Rajput polity. Now, the impacts of the Chaurasia system. Such big estates like a unit of 84 villages, this must be a very big estate, they must have emerged from the process of the distribution of land among the members of the ruling clan, which I have already discussed at the beginning of my lecture, that the Rajputs liked to distribute the neighboring lands within their family only and also within their branch family. In every Rajput kingdom, the Chaurasia system was, however, not followed. But this system must have provided a theoretical frame to the political structure in which the hierarchy of units and the linkages between the clan members and the units could be worked out. So this was a very important aspect feature of land distribution among the Rajputs. Now, the role of forts. Forts were very important in the Rajput polity. Even today, we have several forts in the Rajasthan and Gujarat areas, which are very popular. They were actually set up by these Rajput dynasties. Now, why the forts were so much important in the polity of the Rajputs? The forts actually occupied the central place of the Rajput polity, since everything was controlled from this fort. In earlier period, we have references to the capital, the Rajadhanis. But in this period, we have two kinds of references. One is the Jayaskandhavaras, which we get in the inscriptions of the many regional dynasties. And again, in Rajput, Jayaskandhavaras were actually the temporary military camps set up by the dynasties from which lands were granted. And then again, the inscriptions of the Rajputs, we get references to the forts. These fortified settlements in each unit, these forts actually replaced the capital. The functions which used to be done by the capitals in early period were actually now done by the forts. So forts were very important in the Rajput polity. Fortified settlements in each unit functioned as both administrative centers, and they were also markets for local procedures. There are several references in inscriptions from Rajasthan. As for example, we get reference to Kamakya Kotta in the Bharatpur area, Rajyapura at Rajar in Alwar, Mandavyapura Durga at Mandor near Jodhpur, and Chitrakuta Mahadurga at Chitor. So we have several Sanskrit terms for forts. There we have reference to Kotta, we have reference to Pura, we have reference to Durga. All of these meant to the forts, which are the central place of the Rajput polity, the Rajput kingdom. The role of the forts. The forts represented the numerous foci of power of the ascendant ruling families. They had close links with the landholding in the neighboring areas. These are very apparent from the references to the boundaries of the granted villages in inscriptions. Forts were actually the foci of control for the rural surroundings. How? Let us analyze one inscription. This is the ropey plates of the Paramara king Devaraja. It belongs to 1052 CE. It mentions the grant of a piece of land in the Svabhujyamana Vishaya of Devaraja. Svabhujyamana Vishaya means that this land was the own enjoyment, the Bhujyamana, of this ruler, the Paramara Devaraja. The land was located, the gift land was located to the south of Sri Mallyakotta. Now, Sri Mallyakotta was obviously a kotta, a durga, or a fort. And at its boundaries, there were lands belonging to two brahmanas and a Mahasamantadhipati. So, what I am trying to explain is that the lands were actually always granted near the forts. So, the forts were actually the central focus of the territory of the Rajput. Another inscription of the time of the Paramara Udayaditya from Shergarh in Kota district refers to another fort, and a temple was situated nearby. So now the economic structure of the Rajput kingdoms. The inscriptions suggest clan patrimony as well as clan exclusiveness in the matter of the distribution of the land. How clan patrimony worked? Terms like Vansha Potaka Bhoga. Vansha Potaka Bhoga actually means the bhoga or enjoyment or land that was actually enjoyed, belonged to the sons of the family, the Vansha. This reference we get in the Rajorgar stone inscription of the Mathanadebo, the Gurjara Pratihara king of Alwar. This refers to clan patrimony. Then we have also reference to clan exclusiveness. The Harsha inscriptions of 973 CE from Jaipur refers to the Swabhogas or personal estates of King Singharaja, his two brothers and two sons. Now, the inscription also refers to another assignee, Paras of a Guhila clan who enjoyed a bhoga, and finally it refers to a Dussadhu who was an official. So, we have three types of members who were actually enjoying the land. Some belong to the royal family, some belong to official, some were officers. So, they were members of the royal family who enjoyed land, and there were non-members of the family who also enjoyed land. In the 12th century, the areas under the Chahamanas of Nadol refers to the names of assignments and grasabhumi or bhukti. And by whom they were held? They were held by the kings, the kumaras, the rajaputras and the raggi. Raggi means the queen. So all of these lands were actually held by the members of the royal family. Now, all these administrative policies brought some changes in the meaning of the original term Rajaputra, which is very important. Originally, Rajaputra meant the son of a king, but in early medieval period, the period about which we are now discussing, in this period, Rajaputra actually referred to a large section of the landed aristocracy, and not necessarily all of them were the sons of the Rajputras. So by this process of legitimation, by this process of marriage alliances, the exclusive system of land distribution known as the Chaurasya system, the Rajputs now became the foremost groups of the Kshatriyas. So in early medieval North India, we have two clear groups. When one were simply known as the Kshatriyas and one was the foremost among these Kshatriya groups, they were known as the Rajputs, who are distributed, as I have already pointed out, in western part and the central part of India. The traditional Kshatriya, what happened to the traditional Kshatriyas now? They were also going through a process of change. They are a reference to the son of Kshatriyas as a Sutradhara, a composer of a Prashasti, or another to Kshatriya Vanik. So the traditional Kshatriyas who are non-Rajputs, they were actually going through a process of change and they took to another professions like that of a trader, like that of a composer of Prashasti. Now collaboration among the Rajput clans, there were collaboration in various fields among the Rajput clans. The consolidation of the Rajput structure was also facilitated by the collaboration between the emerging clans in terms of participation in various levels of polity. In earlier period, we have reference to the feudataries of the Rajputras. As for example, one of the good families known as the Gurjaras of Balavi, they actually provided support to the rival of Harshavardhana. So they were actually feudataries. So in this level, they had the overlord and the feudatory relationship. So this is one aspect of such collaboration among the Rajput families, that some of them played the role of overlord while others were feudataries. But there were also other levels of this political relationship, which you will see in this slide. There were circulation of clan members in the courts of other clans. Like the Hansi stone inscription of Prithviraja Chahamana, it actually refers to a fort called Asika Durga that was given to a person of the Guhilo clan. So a member of the Chahamana clan had put in charge another member of the Guhilo clan in charge of a fort, and a person of the Doda clan, now Doda is another Rajput dynasty, another member of the Doda clan was again put in charge of another fort. So in Chahamana polity, we find that members belonging to the Guhilo clan and Doda clan were put in charge of their forts. So in this way, we have collaboration among the Rajput clans. Now we shall summarize our lecture. Thus, in the early stage of the rise of Rajputs, it was an entirely political process. But what happened in the second stage? In the second stage or the last stage, this process of the origin of the Rajputs, or rather the emergence of the Rajput, it had become a social and economic process, since the Rajput families were entering into matrimonial alliances and they were collaborating with several other Rajput dynasties in different levels. So we can say that when in the early stage of the origin of the Rajput, it was exclusively a political process, but later it came to gain some social and other kinds of impact. Thank you.